John, you were getting ready to get onto urinary, correct?
Mm-hmm.
So I think slide 90 should be for you guys as well. Yeah, y'all went all the way past GDD, small intestines, prostate, right?
Yes.
Y'all counted the feti, uterus. Alright, foreign bodies. Beautiful. Talk about enteropathies. Inception. And now, we're at urinary. So kidneys. Okay? So what do we all know about kidneys? The right is more than the left. Alright, perfect. Same thing is going to be visualized on your laterals for the most part. That's a special rule. It's always a special rule, right? But for the most part, you're going to see that right kidney a little bit more cranial. And then on the BD or DD, most likely BD because we're going to be shooting BDs in abdomen, you'll see it more cranial. It gives that kidney bean appearance in the dog. That's where we get the whole kidney bean, the ones you guys eat, right? Most of us eat. And then they're more rounded in the cat. So don't be surprised when you see that plump looking kidney. Usually that's proper, okay? Bolded, to be remembered. 2.5 to 3.5 times the length of L2 in the dog. 2.4 to 3 times the length of L2 in the cat. Alright, that's a good little range to remember. Fat in the retroperitoneum helps us identify their borders. Remember, it's just like a little subsection of the abdominal cavity. The retroperitoneum, okay? And we remember what lives in there, right? Got the aorta, the caudal vena cava, the kidneys, the ureters, some lymph nodes down there in the back, the colon, and then we go, got some other little areas too, so some of the lymphatic tract. All right? That's what helps us see. So when we're not able to necessarily see the abdomen because there's fluid around, sometimes you still can visualize what's going on in the retroperitoneum because it's separated. All right, so when we're dealing with chronic renal disease, we can vary in size and shape. All right, they can be small and irregular, small and narrow, or small and smooth. Okay, whatever the case is, they look different from the normal, which should be a nice kidney bean shaped or rounded with smooth surfaces. Every now and again, you'll see some areas that we call flattened. All right, and those are indicative of something going on with the kidney. All right, so if we were to see this on radiographs, what would be your next step to determine what's going on? Ultrasound, perfect. Biopsy is another one, but not as accessible, but we're gonna start with ultrasound first, right? And we're going to look at the architecture and see what's going on in there. Okay. So that's chronic renal disease. Other imaging possibilities. So we talk about contrast when we're talking about the GI tract, right? Everybody remember that contrast study? Mm-hmm. So what kind of contrast studies do we have in the GI tract? So that's peritoneogram, perfect. Ciliogram, that's the same, peritoneal ciliogram. Barium contrast, so that's just going to be a type of contrast. Remember, there's two types. We have the barium, which should only be used when there's an exit to the outside of the body. So that's GI only. And the iodinated, which we can use within the artery, the cardiovascular system. We can use within the peritoneal cavity. And it's okay. The only time that we don't use iodinated is we're worried about it going into the lungs. You guys remember that talk? Okay. All right. So, what's another GI contrast study? We can use air. So, what's the name? Who worked in the clinic? Who's had a foreign body? Who's worked on a foreign body case? Go ahead. Y'all remember what it was?
Oh, what was the case?
Y'all remember if we used contrast or not? Barium. But what is the specific study called? Barium is a contrast that is used. So I want you guys to get past saying, oh, we're doing a barium study. That's positive, so that's what barium gives you. Iodinated contrast gives you positive too. But when we're talking about gastrogram, right? An upper GI series. That's what we're talking about, okay? A colonogram that ends with gram.
Oh.
Got it?
Peritoneal gram?
Peritoneal, so we already talked about that.
Yeah.
And that's where we inject the iodinated contrast. So it's important for you guys to remember the names of these, all right? So we're not just going to say the barium contrast study or the positive contrast study. Sometimes it may be specific to what it is. Okay? Good now? So that leads me to talk about this. The reason why I spent so much time is because now when you get these words, you need to know what part is being highlighted by the contrast material. All right, so we have an expiratory urogram, which you'll see as EU, or intravenous pyelogram, IVP. What this is doing is injecting contrast into the blood vessel. So you usually have a peripheral catheter. You inject some contrast and it goes through the blood system. Kidneys are one of those things that start highlighting, right? Filters blood, blood goes through it. Anything that's in the blood gets picked up there. Sometimes, some things, right? So, angiogram, so let's take it back to medical terminology. That's when we see the contrast in the arteries, all right? This phase is often missed because it happens so quickly. Blood is flushing, all right? Now, the ones that we use that are specific to this particular study is the nephrogram and the pyelogram. So remember, nephro is the term for kidney as a whole, right? So that's when we're seeing the real blush. You see that beautiful kidney beam. It's nicely delineated. You can even see the right kidney. Can we see that a little bit? Put your microscope back on. That's up here. So you got the caudal pole of the right kidney. You see the beautiful left kidney. Look at that. It's so amazing. Right? That's the nephrogram. The pyelogram is the real meat of the situation. Because now we're seeing the collecting systems, the renal pelvis and the diverticuli. And this one you can see within 3 to 5 minutes. Okay? At that point, you should have the fading of that renal blush. Alright? So the kidney got shy and she blushed, or he blushed. And now he lets you see the insides in his inner workings, or her inner workings, right? So now she lets you see how things are working. So think of it that way. First is the renal blush, then we let you see what's going on. Okay? Y'all okay with that one? Yes,
ma'am.
Yes, this has some of the renal blush going on, but it's also being able to demonstrate it being in those arteries. So you see the renal artery coming in? And you see some of the other blood vessels going to the other areas. But yes, so that's why this one is so immediate that you're going to get a little bit of both. Okay? All right, so why do we like these particular ones? Well, the renal blush is supposed to be nice and smooth and even, just like you put blush on the cheek, so you see your moms and them do that. Right? So if we see an interference with that filling, we get what we call filling defects. Everybody remember what that is? Areas of lucency surrounded by contrast material. I talked about that in GI. All right. So when we see interruptions in that beautiful kidney silhouette, then we worry about filling defects. Okay? Some of those could be some type of infarct or mass that does not have any blood supply or is not able to pick up that contrast. That could be a capillot or mineralization. Okay? Just kind of put your mind to it. Pyelogram. That's used to evaluate that collecting system. Alright? We want to make sure that we see those nice, beautiful projections that are all coming down into the renal pelvis. And then are all going to start going out of the urine. Okay? All right. That's important to note, because when we talk about what do you see on an irregular, if you see something on an irregular pyelogram, that changes your differentials from something that you see on an irregular nephrogram. All right. So, I call myself outlining this because Dr. Perry was going to have you guys try to look at this by yourself with just the little arrows, as you guys see on your slide. All right? So, on your slide, you don't have the circles. But what you're seeing here is bilateral renal megaly. And these are what's typical when you see both kidneys big as heck. Right? You're either dealing with something that's causing acute renal failure, or in the rare instance, you have renal lymphoma, or you have something that's causing bilateral obstructive hydronephrosis. All right? If you're going to say something is obstructive, it needs to be bilateral to be causing both of them to be enlarged. Okay? So this is just like an informational slide. When we're talking unilateral, we're talking obstructive. The difference there. It could be one side. Yes, Tony?
What lumbar vertebrae are we using as reference? Is that L?
L2.
Is there a measurement that we get at the one?
There's on that first slide.
Okay. Sorry.
It's okay. Do you have it on? It should be, this one should be on Blackboard for you all.
Yes.
Okay. But thank you, Tony, for trying to take notes without using your slides. But it is 2.5 to 3.5 for the dog and 2.4 to 3 in the cat. Right? I'm testing out. That's what I'm like, no, that's part of your slides, eh?
Mm-hmm.
But good job.
Yes, ma'am. I don't see the enlarged kidney. I mean, like, can you, like, outline it other than, like,
yes. Sure I can. Okay, so let me come off of this. And hold on. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take my little circle off. And then I'm going to go back to the slide. All right, so you see where the arrow is pointing right here? This is that common pole of the right kidney.
Okay.
And it's pretty much taking all of this up and kind of coming around. And it dips in here to its pelvis.
Okay.
But it's pretty much from a little bit around this rib all the way down here. Okay, the cranial pole is harder to delineate. So I'm trusting where her arrow is here. But I can definitely show you where that common pole is.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. You want to be careful because we might be looking at the labor lobe.
I was going to ask, what is that?
Oh, sorry.
Oh, that was
liver lobe there.
Okay.
Yeah. And because most of this is cut off, I can't confidently tell you that. All right, I can only assume that that's either the liver lobe, might be the cranial pole. Which is why I said it's hard to really make out the cranial pole of it because they cut out that cranial part of the abdomen. Which is why, going all the way back to the beginning lectures, it's important to have proper collimation and positioning when we're evaluating the abdomen, right? Because now you see how important it is for me to see the cranial abdomen so that I can determine is that part of the liver or is that actually the cranial pole of that kidney? Because remember, they're so close in a relationship to each other, right? They kind of sit right on each other. So that's why it's important to have that. So that's a good example. But what you're seeing here is kind of the residual effect of that contrast study. You're seeing it come out of the ureter and into the urinary bladder. So now, by the end of that study, you're going to see a lot of that contrast material within the urinary bladder. So you'll expect to see that. All right? Any other questions on the slide? Yes, sir.
The bladder's super bright because of the
contrast.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir. All right. All right, so on this one, you're looking at a renal blush, okay? You see nice filling and nice outlet and silhouette of the right kidney. What you have superimposed are the intestines. Over here, we see nice filling of the cranial aspect of the left kidney, and then we have a filling defect, right? We have a cyst on the caudal pole of the left kidney, and that's what you're seeing here. Everybody see that outline? I got like a wobbly Tracy. Okay? So that's a filling defect. They don't have a spleen. Okay, sorry. All right, so small canine kidneys. So this arrow is showing you from the cranial pole to the caudal pole of the left. You don't really see the right very well, so we just measure from the left side, and you're measuring against L2. Okay? Very small and narrow. So some of those conditions could be chronic renal disease, like we talked about on one of the first slides, dysplasia or hypoplasia. Okay? So, FYI slide, differentials to consider. Where you see unilateral pelvic dilation and hydroureter, or ureter that's extra dilated. These are some, hydronephrosis from masses or capillae in the renal pelvis. You can have ureteral obstruction that could be intraluminal or extraluminal. So there could be a mass somewhere outside of the ureter in the retroperitoneal space that's causing obstruction. Or you can have ectopic ureter. Other things to consider of ureteral obstruction is masses at its entry into the urinary bladder. So what mass or what type of soft tissue mass can you think of that would affect its entry into the urinary bladder? Yes. So if we have thickening at the neck of the bladder because of a transitional cell carcinoma, we're going to have some type of obstruction to that ureter being able to empty out into the bladder, causing then hydroureter and then renal pelvic dilation. All right. When we talk about bilateral, talking about pyelonephritis, something systemic, okay? This is typically an ascending infection from the urinary bladder, and then also the mass at the trigon, because sometimes we can have one side of it thicken, and maybe not the other side, because maybe depending on how early on the development is, but most likely you're going to see bilateral, okay? Other things to consider when you see pelvic dilation is, has this dog been on fluids? Okay. Well, those are other considerations for pelvic dilation. All right. And that's what it looks like. So this is from a chronic pyelonephritis. And you guys see how it looks just broadened, right? You're not really seeing those little fingerlings. Just looks thick. Okay, and I have another example for you. So this is what the normal looks like, right? Nice, thin. You see all the collecting ducts coming down. Here's a dilated one. Just big and just ugly. And look at how thick that ureter is and convoluted it is. It's not following a nice line. Okay? Here goes another one where you have hydronephrosis and you have that dilation. See, here was a normal ureter coming up from the right kidney. You can't really even see this one here. And again, this is an abnormal one. This is one that we saw from the previous slide. This is looking at it on lateral aspect. So normally we should see these guys kind of a nice thin line, almost look like there's some arteries or veins, some vessels. And then you can see them as they go into the bladder. So remember, they kind of go in and hook in. And then now you see it thicken all the way through. Everybody see this? And then it comes in. Okay, so this is an ectopic ureter. Have you guys discussed anything about ectopic ureters yet? Anybody want to take a gander on what an ectopic ureter is? Not in the right place. Okay. So sometimes these ureters don't go to the right place at the neck of the bladder, and they can tunnel through tissue, which causes them obstruction, right? Because they're going through these tight tissue areas. Some of them can go and bypass the bladder and go straight into the urethra or into the vaginal canal, okay? Those are those things that we consider when we talk about ectopic ureter. Okay? So, yes, ma'am.
When you mentioned the unilateral versus bilateral masses, would both of those still be considered part of the PCP? Or there would PCP still be a differential for both unilateral and bilateral?
Because sometimes you can see the thickening of that neck of the bladder on one side more than the other, I would still put it on your differential list, but just keep it lower. Yes, sir.
For these ectopic ureters, hydroureters, is there a reference where we can measure it, or is this going to be by experience and subjective analysis?
It's going. It's no no reference into measuring. You're just going to be looking at how thick and dilated they are.
Okay.
So ureters, as you guys have seen in surgery, very small, hard to even see, right? Which is why they're usually easily picked up with the ovaries on some cases, right? We talk about that as being a problem in surgery. So when we see them thickened or highlighted very well with the contrast study, that's when we worry about it, all right? So these are some further examples of those contrast imaging talking about where the ureters enter the urinary bladder. As you can see, there's a very thin line followed by the arrow. So I'm gonna be back to the mouse and trying to slowly talk. All right, so you see one here? You guys see that?